Nearly every airplane ever built has used moving control surfaces to subtly change its shape during flight, altering the aerodynamic pressures and forces to achieve what is called aircraft maneuvering. But what if these control surfaces are removed? A groundbreaking technological advancement that could revolutionize the way planes are designed and flown is on the way. Imagine an aircraft that can fly without traditional moving flight controls on the exterior. An X-plane of DARPA's crane program is demonstrating a game-changing technology on this concept. But why would they want to do that? Let's explore in this video. I'm Abhishek and welcome to Revolutionary Engineering. By eliminating the weight and mechanical complexity of moving control surfaces, DARPA aims to unlock a realm of possibilities. They want to enhance fuel efficiency, reduce drag, and push the boundaries of aerodynamic performance. Global air traffic has been on a rise since 2004. After a dip for a short period in 2020, it's been rising even more steeply. It is estimated that by mid-2030s, at least 200,000 flights per day are expected to take off and land all over the world. Hence, there is going to be a significant rise in carbon footprint of the aviation industry in the coming years. Thus arises the need to make flights more efficient. Before diving further to see how this technology works and how it could lead to much better fuel efficiency, let's first see what's the purpose of these flight control surfaces. Motion of the aircraft can be defined about the three axes, namely the vertical axis about which the aircraft yaws, longitudinal axis about which it rolls, and the transverse axis about which it pitches. The control surfaces steer the plane during flight and keep the movement in control about these three axes. The elevators control the pitch motion, the rudder controls the yaw, and the ailerons control the roll. The flaps and spoilers are the secondary control surfaces. Flaps modify the lift that the wings generate. Depending on how much is the angle of inclination of the flap, they can slow down the airplane or generate a little more lift during takeoff. This can also be seen in the pressure contour from computational modeling of the flap. Spoilers and air brakes used in the landing process or after landing reduce the lift on the wings and slow down the aircraft at the same time. So one thing is clear, that in absence of control surfaces, the aircraft simply cannot fly. But the new X-plane manages to get the desired control and on top of it, better fuel efficiency in the absence of these control surfaces. The secret lies in replacing the control surfaces with the fluid the plane moves through, the air. Active flow control systems utilize compressed air to manipulate the airflow around the aircraft. By strategically blasting jets of air at supersonic speeds from nozzles embedded along the trailing edges of the wings and control surfaces, this approach enables unprecedented maneuverability and control. These jets that can also be embedded on the leading edge interact with the flow around the entire wing, causing an increase or decrease in lift on the part of the wing where the air jets are actually blown. By doing so, the pitching, rolling, or yawing moment generated can be used to maneuver the aircraft. This can replace the more conventional moving control surfaces such as flaps and ailerons that are currently used for this purpose. Notice how the roll is achieved by blowing air jets during successful demonstration of this technology in the unmanned aerial vehicle Magma by BAE Systems back in 2019. It can even be used for what is called four-body blowing. In this, narrow slots are located around the edge of the aircraft nose and are used for blowing air jets. If air is blown through these slots, it changes the way the vortices form around the nose of the aircraft, thus changing the aerodynamics around it. In this way, if four-body blowing is activated only on one side, it creates asymmetry in the four-body vortices, causing a side force and yawing moment to act on the front of the aircraft and can be used to maneuver it. But active flow control's impact goes beyond maneuverability. By actively managing the boundary layer, which is the thin layer of air adjacent to the aircraft's surface, AFC can also be used to reduce drag and enhance fuel efficiency. And how this happens? Let's see in detail. In general, a laminar flow around a body, such as the airfoil, can minimize flow losses and is characterized by smooth, parallel layers of fluid moving in a coordinated manner. For very streamlined bodies like the airfoil, At low angles of attack, pressure drag is quite small as the flow separation either does not occur at all or is significantly delayed. For such bodies, the majority of the drag is due to the wall shear stresses, and the name given to the drag component due to these stresses is friction drag. Friction drag increases with viscosity of fluid, and also the bodies with large surface area have a larger friction drag. But in this particular case of discussion, the friction drag is less of a concern as active flow control does not change or interfere with the geometry of the airfoil. Also, at a higher angle of attack, a large fraction of the flow over the top surface of the airfoil may be separated. At this stage, the pressure drag is much greater than the viscous or friction drag. And this happens because the flow decelerates with increasing area of flow near the boundary layer, and thus the pressure increases. Due to this increase in pressure, the flow reverses in direction. And since it cannot travel backwards due to the oncoming fluid, it detaches from the surface, resulting in flow separation and creating a region of recirculating flow. This creates low pressure behind the airfoil, which causes the drag force. So it is the pressure drag that needs a greater attention, particularly at higher angles of attack. Now, if the air jets are blown on the surface of the airplane wing, the flow separation is delayed and thus the pressure drag is significantly reduced, reducing the overall drag. In certain cases, the flow may encounter extreme adverse pressure gradients, and preventing boundary layer separation can be challenging. Even in such cases, active flow control can be deployed to delay flow separation by introducing controlled turbulence in much the same way as vortex generators on the airplane wing. But as vortex generator is a passive way to introduce turbulence, active control is an active way to achieve it, and thus can be optimized and adjusted in real time, providing greater flexibility. Now, this may sound counterintuitive, but the turbulent boundary layer better resists separation compared to laminar flow. In fact, it can usually follow the profile of a body longer than a laminar flow. This is because the increased mixing within a turbulent boundary layer allows it to adhere to the body's profile for a longer distance. This becomes clearer with this profile. With the turbulent boundary layer, the velocity in the y direction increases faster than with a laminar boundary layer. What it means is a larger velocity gradient near the wall and thus higher velocity components in the boundary layer. The resulting higher kinetic energy of the boundary layer can counteract the adverse pressure gradient, resulting in the separation point to shift downstream. This reduces the pressure drag and thus the flow losses. Now, whatever I have said about the drag reduction becomes quite easy to visualize when you see a golf ball flying in the air. The dimples in the ball causes vortices that lead to a turbulent flow around the ball, thus shifting the separation point downstream, narrowing the turbulent wake and reducing drag by more than 50% compared to a smooth ball, making the golf ball fly much farther. This is exactly what can be achieved in planes with AFC by blowing air jets. By reducing drag and improving fuel efficiency, there is going to be a good reduction in pollution and significant savings in fuel costs. AFC technology opens up new horizons for stealth designs too, minimizing radar cross-section and ensuring the utmost efficiency even in the most critical missions. Radar cross-section, or RCS, simply means how detectable an object is by radar. So RCS of the target is the area that intercepts the radar's transmitted signals and reflects them back to the radar receiver. Active flow control can help maintain smooth surfaces and thus reduce radar cross-section. For instance, it can reduce the radar signature of deployed flaps or other movable control surfaces by actively controlling the flow. The elimination of so many moving parts also means fewer things, improving reliability and maintenance requirements. Four companies were hired to conduct initial crane-related design studies. The design that was finalized had a coplanar joint wing platform consisting of two sets of wings attached to a single center fuselage that merged together at the tips, along with a twin vertical tail arrangement. Banks of nozzles are installed at various points on the wings to maneuver in the air. Aurora Flight Sciences, a research subsidiary of Boeing, is planning a full-sized unmanned aircraft that will showcase the power of AFC. During the Phase 1 test, Aurora completed 4 weeks of wind tunnel testing on a quarter-size prototype in a San Diego facility. In Phase 3, Aurora will build the full prototype that will weigh 3.5 tons with wingspan over 9 meters. The Aurora Flight Sciences design is of course not the first time AFC technology has been experimented with. UK headquartered BAE Systems, which was another one of the participants for Crane's initial studies, has been experimenting with various AFC concepts since 2010. A notable milestone was achieved in 2019 with Magma, a proof-of-concept subscale demonstrator UAV with fully controlled flight using active flow control with supersonically blown air. In the past, the implementation of AFC on an aircraft faced challenges due to the inability to justify the cost and benefits of a fully integrated system because of excessive energy requirements to achieve the benefit, and also such a system added significant weight. However, recent advancements and emerging technologies like 3D printing have enabled the development and production of intricate, lightweight, and efficient structures. Furthermore, significant progress is made in understanding and optimizing flow controls through advancements in computing power, improved CFD simulations, and advanced diagnostic techniques used in wind tunnels and systems. With the greatly improved understanding of active flow control over the past decade or so, and through extensive research, it can be implemented more efficiently. But few things about the X-plane are still unclear, like the aircraft's main engine arrangement. An air intake under the forward fuselage and a single exhaust nozzle at the rear, visible in wind tunnel models, seem to suggest a single jet engine powered flight. Also, the power source to generate compressed air for the AFC nozzle banks is not fully disclosed. Concept art of DARPA appears to show a separate intake on top of the nose and a smaller exhaust on top of midsection of the fuselage that might be tied to the AFC system. With its coplanar joint wing platform and banks of AFC nozzles, this X-plane might redefine the future of flight, more sustainable and more efficient with better maneuverability. What do you think of the future of energy efficient flights? Don't forget to comment with your thoughts. Also, I would really appreciate you subscribing to my channel, as you'd probably find some other videos of your interest, like this one on a simple yet breakthrough material for storing thermal energy.